Hi, I'm Emily Madan, and today I'm going to walk you through a foundational GMAT problem. So take a look at the problem on your screen, take a few minutes, and give it a try. There's a couple of things that you should have noticed. First of all, there are really large numbers involved in this problem, and you don't have a calculator. So some of you may have been sitting there trying to multiply 81 times 81, and that's not actually what the GMAT asks you to do or wants you to do. First, take a look at the answer choices. There's a hint in here. The answer choices all have a base of 3. Now, that's not in the original problem, but we can use that to infer maybe we should get this into base of 3. These large numbers can absolutely be broken down into 3s. Whenever you have large numbers raised to an exponent, break them down into smaller factors. We know that 9 is the same thing as 3 squared, and 81 is 9 squared. So I can continue that on and say, well, 81 is 9 squared, meaning it is 3 squared squared. Now, if you studied your exponent rules, what you can do to simplify this further, whenever you see one exponent raised to another exponent, you actually multiply those two terms together. So this 3 squared squared term is going to become 3 to the fourth. So now I have all the terms with a base of 3. Let me put them back into the original problem. So 81, 3 to the fourth squared, minus 9, 3 squared cubed. That's what the problem is asking me. We can simplify this further by raising one exponent to another. So 3 to the 4th squared is 3 to the 8th minus 3 squared cubed, 3 to the 6th. Now, at this point, you may be tempted to do an incorrect simplification and say, well, these both have a base of 3, and 8 minus 6 is 2, so this simplifies to 3 squared. However, that's not correct. Please don't fall for this. And this may actually be one of the answer choices on a real GMAT question. Instead, when you get two different terms with exponents and you need to combine them, if they're added, if they're subtracted, what you'll need to do is factor out a common term. So in this case, the common term I want to factor out is 3 to the 6th. When I factor out a 3 to the 6th, I can rewrite this expression as 3 to the 6th times 3 squared minus 1. And the way that I'm getting those two terms is going to the original and saying 3 to the 8th divided by 3 to the 6th. Well, that's the same thing as 3 squared. And 3 to the 6th divided by 3 to the 6th, that's the same thing as 1. So the whole expression is 3 to the 6th times 3 squared minus 1. We are so close to having this in its most simplified form, but take a look at the answer choices. There's only one that includes a 3 to the 6th, so even without finishing this problem, I'm already inclined to think B is a pretty good answer. That said, let's keep moving forward with this. Now, I'm not going to multiply out 3 to the 6th. That's too large a number. But instead, I can multiply out 3 squared and put this as 9 minus 1, which of course then simplifies out to 3 to the 6th times 8. Again, very close to our answer choice, but not identical. Take a look at what the answer choice actually says. It's 3 to the 6th times 2 cubed. Well, 2 cubed is the same thing as 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. So what answer choice B is really saying is 3 to the 6th times 8, which we just determined is our answer. Okay? So what I want you to take from this is that when you see large numbers raised to powers, or when you see exponents with different bases, work on converting those exponents to all having the same bases, so you can then combine or factor out and create a much simpler expression that then will match up with the answer choices. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep, and leave a comment telling us how you solved this one. Happy studying.